Hello, I'm Simon Whistler. You're watching Today I Found Out, and in the video today, the fact that fire hydrant colors actually mean something. One of the first challenges that firefighters face when they arrive at a fire is finding a suitable water source that provides enough water for the type of fire they are fighting. Obviously, a car fire will require much less water than a burning apartment building. There are formulas used by firefighters that will tell them approximately how much water is needed to fight a given fire. To help in locating a suitable fire hydrant quickly for a given fire, they are commonly color-coded to indicate how much water a particular hydrant will provide, which can vary greatly. For instance, due to the numerous different water supply systems throughout the United States, an available supply from a given hydrant might range from 500 GPM, that's gallons per minute or less, to over 2,500 GPM. As for this color coding, this varies considerably, not just throughout the world, but even within a country. In general, we're going to keep this related to the United States because there's a lot to cover even in that country alone. To wit, the National Fire Protection Agency, NFPA, recommends that fire departments and water districts follow a set standard of color coding. Known as NFPA 291, it says fire hydrants using public water supply systems should be painted chrome yellow, and their tops and caps should indicate the available GPM. Below 500 GPM should be red, 500 to 999 GPM should be orange, 1000 to 1499 GPM should be green, and 1500 GPM or more should be blue. If the fire hydrant is not hooked to the public water system, but instead is accessing a private system, as in the case of a shared well by several houses in a specific neighborhood, the hydrant should be painted a color distinguishing it from a publicly supplied system. In this case, the NFPA recommends the color red. OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health Administration, further recommends that a hydrant be painted violet for any source that is non-potable. Of course, doing this potentially causes problems when trying to tell if a given hydrant is both non-potable and from a private source. Furthermore, if a hydrant is inoperable, it's recommended that it be painted black. If it's just going to be inoperable for a short time, though, well, it's common just to place a black bag over the hydrant. So GPM is one of only two factors in water supply. The other is pressure, which is rated by PSI or pounds per square inch. All hydrants are assumed to provide at least 20 PSI. If it doesn't, NFPA recommends that the rated pressure be stenciled on the top of the hydrant and on the caps. They also recommend this for extremely high-pressured hydrants. Too much pressure can cause damage to the fire equipment if precautions aren't taken. The NFPA sets these standards, and most fire departments and water companies try to follow them. In the end, however, these are just guidelines and are not necessarily requirements. As such, not every area will follow these recommendations. In 2005, Firehouse.com conducted a poll of firefighters and other fire service personnel asking if their departments use this color coding system. 47% did, and 44% did not. 8% of respondents simply did not have hydrants in their areas. In cases where there were no hydrants, water supply trucks, known as tenders, will fill up with water from nearby sources such as lakes and rivers, and then bring it to the fire. Also consider that the NFPA recommendation is not the only color coding system used. Many different municipalities create their own for their specific situation. For instance, the Moraga-Arinda Fire Department in California has taken to color coding the tops of the hydrants following the NFPA recommendations. Then they color code the caps for the specific PSI provided. They also mark for dead-end hydrants, hydrants only supplied from one direction. They have their own hydrant body color system and an arrow system indicating higher pressure hydrants. They also provide Roman numeral markings that indicate where the shutoff valves are for that particular hydrant. So when you are driving around your neighborhood and see a hydrant painted a specific color, be assured that that color has a specific purpose. Some people who have fire hydrants on their properties are known to decorate them or hide them in some way because they think it's a bit of an eyesore. Just note that if you do that, you might get a knock on your door from the local water district or fire department telling you that your art is not appreciated. And now for some bonus facts. In major water systems, like those that supply large cities and towns, the most common supply method is a gridded system. In this type of system, every distribution pipe is interconnected with one another. Should a specific pipe become damaged or clogged, the water can be supplied from another direction, providing uninterrupted water flow for the end user. If the hydrant is only supplied from one direction, it is commonly known as a dead-end hydrant. And now for another bonus fact. Fire needs four things to sustain itself: heat, fuel, oxygen, and the chemical reaction between the three. Should you want to put the fire out, you simply have to take away one of these four things. Obviously, water application is the most common method used here. Water puts out the fire in two ways. The first is common sense. It cools the fuel burning below the temperature required to keep it burning, known as its fire point. The second factor, though, is less obvious. In an enclosed environment, the heat available turns the water to steam. The steam replaces the available oxygen in the area and, in effect, smothers the fire. The amount of steam created by the water used depends on several factors, including atmospheric pressure, temperature of the environment, and temperature of the water. For practical purposes, firefighters use a ratio of 1,700 to 1, the volume of steam being 1,700 times the volume of water used. And now for another bonus fact. The proper amount of water needed to fight a given fire is one of the most important factors in deciding how to fight a particular fire. Too little water, then the fire won't go out, and too much, and you get water damage to the rest of the property that you're trying to protect. To illustrate this, imagine that you have a fire on the top floor of your house, and the entire bottom floor becomes ruined because of an overzealous firefighter. Perhaps unsurprisingly, there are many different aspects to the formula for determining the correct amount of water needed to fight a given fire, things like the type of material burning, volume of the space the fire is in, and the type of fire hose nozzle chosen. These are just a few of the factors. Like most things in the fire service, the most common method used simply gives an approximation of the needed GPM. The given volume of burning material is divided by 3. So I really hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, please do give us a thumbs up below, and don't forget to subscribe. I'd also like to take this moment to thank our patrons on Patreon. If you're interested in supporting us with a small and voluntary financial contribution, please do consider heading over to patreon.com/todayIFoundOut. We've got loads of great perks lined up for people who support us, so please do go check those out. And as always, thank you for watching.